Pie, which tonight is simply sensational. So keep your eyes open, your ears peeled, your nostrils flared, your tongue hanging out, and your hands to yourself as we meet. A sight for sore eyes, it's Jessica Fostekew. A touch of class, Roisin Conaty. Taste of heaven, Aisling B. Oh. And somehow still here, Alan Davis. And their sounds are a feast for the senses. Jessica goes.
I see trees of green.
Oh, lovely.
Red.
Roisin goes.
I hear music. Mighty fine music.
Aisling goes.
Oh, yeah.
I can't touch this.
Alan goes.
Oh, I think I smell all right. Oh, I think I smell all right.
Sorry about that. Now, on with the questions. What's the main sense that a typist uses?
Sense of foreboding because you're soon to be unemployed because of the never-ending advancement of technology.
Ooh, that is a very good idea. There are, as I think Alan will know from previous episodes, there are more than five senses. Depends on how you define them. There are sort of between 9 and 26, to be honest. But we are thinking of one called proprioception.
You know the Oceptions.
Yes. We are talking...
Ah, proprioception! A lovely man, but a racist.
It's also known as kinesthesia. It's the body's ability to sense its movement and location without looking. So it's why we don't have to look at our feet when we walk, or we don't have to look at the fork when we eat. And it allows the body to perform simultaneous actions without stopping to think about each one separately, so you can dribble a basketball while running. And touch typing is achieved through this, through proprioception, knowing where the keys are without looking. So the only thing that you really need in order to get started is, you know, the F and the J have a little raised thing on them, and that tells
yes,
you...
that's why they're there.
I wondered why they had a nipple.
That's it!
I thought they were the keyboard's boobs.
Jess just texts me like FJ, 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 FJ. All right, Jess. You really love texting for Jew.
When I was at school, we all the girls were taught to touch type and to do speed writing or shorthand. Mm-hmm. And the way we were taught was you had an apron, a black apron, that went over the back of the typewriter and round the back of your neck. And then you had to put your hands in underneath.
I bet all sorts went on under there. Oh. Not the one used for a space bar.
Yeah.
Well, actually, Ellen, a lot of good novels are written there, so up yours.
I type so much now that I think better by not looking. If you have to handwrite, it takes forever.
Yeah, if you had written a letter recently...
Oh, it's hell.
By the third page, it looked like I was sending it like a death threat. I was just, like, scrawling. I can't... There's no way to sustain this. I just had to end the letter. But I was like, things are fine in the end.
You need proprioception, all of us do, in order, for example, to touch your nose with your eyes shut. So if you shut your eyes and try and touch your nose...
No problem.
Nope.
I slowed down when I did it, because I genuinely thought I was going way off. I definitely went round the house.
When would you be way off? Oh. When is an example of when you would be way off with that?
I've no idea, and it's handy if we get adrift.
Drunk?
Yeah. It's one of the sobriety tests that are used. There is a quick way to demonstrate proprioception. So put an arm in the air with the fist clenched, OK, but your thumb sticking out. Close your eyes and grab your thumb with your thumb and forefinger of the other hand.
For a second, I thought I could cheat by watching everyone else.
Yeah. Is someone undoing my flies?
Well, I have to get the fun where I can, Alan.
Just looking for the space bar.
Yeah. So it's along with our sense of touch, temperature, pain, movement, it's all part of what's called the somatosensory system. So it's the sensation that can occur anywhere on the body as opposed to in a particular organ like the eye. Right, moving on. During the Renaissance, who ate better than a king?
Would it be maybe the king's, like, servant or, like, waiter?
Why?
Because I had lots of waiting jobs as a teenager and I ate loads. I ate loads of the stuff off the plates.
You were heading in the right direction, but not quite getting there.
Because they'd have a poison tester. Would a king or queen have poison a poison tester? Yeah.
It's the poison tester. They would taste everything in Renaissance Europe that the royal had to eat, and also large amounts of it, not just a nibble. If it was just a nibble, you wouldn't pick up enough poison. They had to eat spoonfuls from the royal plate.
Yes.
And if it was beautifully intact, say it had a sort of pastry lid or something, they would have to break it open and dip bread into the dishes. By the time the poor royal received their meal, it was probably cold and half-eaten, or demolished, in fact.
What if the poison tester's the poisoner?
That's
genius!
There's murder.
The novel writes itself.
Constantly making that things look dodgy. I don't know. Oh, if it's like something with rhubarb in it, you're fine. Yeah. Oh, it's poison.
Or a Brussels sprout.
There was a physician called Amboise Paré. He was a physician to four kings of France. And he wrote in 1585, anybody afraid of being poisoned should be wary of meats cooked with much art, very sweet, salty, sour, or notably endued with any other taste. So,
was he my Uncle Alan?
In Paris time, it was believed that bezoar stones could cure the effects of any poison. Anybody know what a bezoar stone is? There is one.
A badly cooked potato.
Well, it's food-related thing.
Is it? Is it something's turd?
You are the closest. It's an undigested mass found in the digestive system. Bezoar is Persian for antidote or counter poison, and the theory was that if you had a bezoar stone, it would cure you. So they decided to do a test on this, and they performed an experiment. This same guy, Paré, that I was telling you about, this 16th century physician, he performed an experiment on a cook at the king's court. The cook had been caught stealing some fine silver cutlery, and he was sentenced to death by hanging. So the cook agreed to be poisoned instead, and Paré then used the bezoar stone to cure him. Cook died in agony 7 hours later. Yeah.
I'm confused. Is that an old poo?
No, it's undigested stuff from
the
inside.
It's got the makings of a poo, but it never got out.
Yeah.
It's a poo fetus.
It's a potential poo.
It's a wannabe poo.
Yeah.
All poos are equal in your God's eyes. Don't touch it. Wait for it to come out. God intended, out the back.
They were really valuable. They could be worth 10 times their weight in gold.
But did they have to cut open a person to get them out?
That's the question.
No, I don't think you can go out the back and find it.
Yeah, just have a rummage. I don't think that it's like.
How did
that? That's more like Bollywood.
It's a bit late to tell me that now, Alan.
How did you talk to someone else?
You've got your evening planned.
They mostly came out of animals like goats and not humans, so.
It's a bit disconcerting that it's sort of nestling in a Moses basket.
Yeah.
We do love him. Now, we were going to get rid of him at one stage, but now we have to say, absolutely over the moon with this bezoar stone.
Only a mother could love it.
Time now for a sensory demonstration. I'm going to give you a hearing test. OK, let me get out my little keyboard. Oh. Here we go. Now, you should have some whiteboards and some pens there.
Yes.
So, I'm going to play you two notes. You have to write down which is higher or lower, OK? So, I'm going to play this note, don't look, and then this note, higher or lower. OK? So, what's everybody got?
Higher.
Higher?
Yeah.
Higher?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, it's correct. It's absolutely right.
Oh, God! Good, OK.
OK, fine. So, now we're going to play you some stuff that has been created by a computer, and I'm going to play you three sets, and I want you to write down on each occasion whether the second note is higher or lower. OK, really simple.
Yeah.
Really simple. Did the note go up or did the note go down?
Yes.
Here we go. Up or down?
But we only get one go.
Yeah. OK, next one. Up or down?
Well, that's very tricky, isn't it?
Yes. I feel like there's more than one note sneaking in there each time.
Mm-hmm. And the third one. Oh, Roisin's very confident with that one. OK.
Wrong.
Turn all the boards round. Let's have a quick look. So you have got lower, lower, higher. You have basically got lower, higher, higher. Lower, higher, lower.
Hang on.
Higher, lower, higher. I mean, they're all different.
Is this gold dress, blue dress, but for the ears?
It is an auditory illusion.
I'd just like to point out that I haven't drawn a cock and balls.
Well done.
Do you want to do it now? Would you feel better?
I thought, I think, you know, in terms of children, you'd say this was a developmental milestone.
I'd say that this is a sign of maturity. So, the truth is that what you were listening to, the tones go both up and down. It is called the tritone paradox. So there's two notes effectively being played. It's like C and F sharp at the same time.
Ah.
And then the next note is one in the middle. And the consequence of that is it's both higher and lower, depending
that's
on
what you said.
Which
there's
note
more than one
seemed
note
more
going
prominent.
On.
So you are all correct. It doesn't really matter which you put, whether you put up or down, or higher or lower. Shall we hear it again? Let's see if you can hear it now.
Huh. I don't like it. So that's your doorbell. Oh, you'd never answer.
It's a bit annoying, isn't it? It's just an illusion, so that it sounds as if, frankly, it could go up and down. But what's most interesting about it was analysed by a music psychologist called Diana Deutsch in 1986, and what she realised is what we hear, whether we hear it going up or whether we hear it going down, very much depends on our culture, on our language.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, the perception is probably going to be the same as your parents. It's probably going to be the same as sort of people in the area that you live. People who have a very much more musical language will hear it differently from people who are rather sort of straightforward with their language. I think it's fascinating. It'll tell you something about people just whether they say it's higher or lower.
Wow. That's fascinating, even in terms of what makes the sound of a joke, how you play it, the sound of your voice in different cultures. Can you hear a joke happening if you don't understand the language and the rhythm of something and what cadence works in different cultures?
Yeah.
I'd love someone to tell my mum that. I've got a mum who's really desperate to have somebody in our family who's really good at any kind of instrument or anything. Oh. So now I can tell her I am, because I do comedy.
Are you musical, Alan? Not in the slightest.
He's drawn a lovely dick and balls, though. So he is still artistic.
Right, let's nose around for another question. Here's one. Ooh. OK, what do banks smell of?
Money.
Money. it depends on the bank, is the truth of it.
Ooh,
it depends on what scent they have decided to associate the bank with.
Scent.
Yeah. So it could be grapefruit, could be cardamom, could be chocolate. We're in the world of scent marketing, so environmental scenting. It's the scent that is introduced into a retail or a leisure environment. It's really big business.
Makes you part with your money.
It does, darling. It works because it sends signals to our limbic system, which is the sector of the brain that controls memory and emotion, and it absolutely works. The very first bank to try this was the National Australia Bank headquarters in Melbourne, and they introduced the scent of lime and grapefruit.
Ooh.
In 2012.
They're quite happy scents.
Yes,
happy scents, yes. And some high-end banks, as sort of financial institutions, use signature scents that are supposed to lend a sense of luxury to their clientele.
Very nice.
One bank selected a premium fragrance that begins with mouth-watering mandarin, fresh, watery ozone, and green cardamom notes supported by black pepper and musk.
Oh, musk!
Musk.
Mm. That's lovely.
I don't want that in a bank. Do you want that in a bank?
I don't want musk in a bank, no. I don't want to get pregnant off the air in a bank.
Well, casinos have found, depending on the scent that they use in the casino, people will gamble more.
Wow.
So the Las Vegas Hilton found that people spent 50% more time playing in the casino if there were floral smells. I like the idea of sort of quite a lot of rough gamblers going, oh, it's nice in here.
Oh, yeah. Winter Vegas casinos and people smoking.
It's still smoking?
There. Yeah, in the casino.
I love a casino.
Do you?
Oh, God.
Oh, my God, Sandy. The most random fact.
I would never.
Fastick loves a casino. She loves
she
gambling.
She goes in the roulette wheel.
Oh, my God. Like
I'm going for 4K. Yeah. Wish me luck. It's red. It's red. It's red.
That is so funny.
Oh,
so, Las Vegas, they all have different smells. The Mirage is Polynesian, the Mandalay Bay is Southeast Asian, and the Bellagio, whispers of Northern Italy.
Oh,
I know.
And cigars and cigarette smoke, mainly.
Yeah. So, scent marketing is a thing. Jewellers, gyms, dentists, funeral parlours, all kinds of people use it now. It's very popular in supermarkets, scent marketing. So, in New York, for example, they have fresh bread in the bread aisle, grapefruit in the fruit aisle, that kind of thing. But it's not the only trick that supermarkets play. Some supermarkets use smaller floor tiles in front of the more expensive sections. And the reason is, as you notice, the clicking of your trolley wheels is becoming faster. You don't realise it's the tiles becoming smaller. You instinctively slow down. You feel like you've sped up because you can hear the wheels kind of going like this. You just say, oh, it's going a bit too fast.
Any choices our own?
Nothing. Absolutely nothing.
We spray perfume. We're all, like, doing the cell. Like, it's just like, who are we?
Right. This question is not as senseless as it sounds. What kind of dog can tell the time?
I hear music.
A good boy.
A watchdog?
Hey.
I asked for it.
What about a clocker spaniel? There's no original thought left.
Who's got dogs? I've got a dog, you've got a dog, you've got a dog. Well, so have you ever noticed that when you get home, your dog seems to be waiting for you? How does the dog know what time it is?
It waits there all day, surely. Yeah. They're like...
No, definitely not. Definitely they don't do that.
My dog, she would get up and start yelling the place down before the doorbell rang. She could tell someone was approaching the property.
Sure, they can hear if somebody's approaching the property, but how might they know what time it is?
Well, there's something, and I'm probably going to say this wrong, but there's... When they go to the toilet, they put their bum to the sun, the south, always to the south. I got told this quite recently, and it's maybe if it's QI, cut it if it's wrong. But I think it's...
Were you on a show called Gullible?
The more I'm talking on it, the more I'm losing faith in it.
Well, there is some thought that they do prefer to poo along the north-south axis, and it's to do with magnetic fields, but we don't know if that's true or not. So it might be your smell is the thing. So it is not that you stink.
My smell?
No, a human being smell. It's not that you smell as you come up the path or whatever. After you leave the house, your scent lingers, and they have phenomenal sense of smell, and it decays slowly over the day. If you have a fairly regular schedule, the dog will notice when your smell has declined to a certain level that it associates with you coming home.
Wow.
And then if it disappears completely, it thinks you're dead. And then when you open the door, it acts as if you've come back. Every time you come home. Oh, my God, I thought you were dead! You were definitely dead! It's a miracle!
There's a dog researcher called Alexandra Horowitz, and what she did was she tested this thing about the smell by placing several sort of fairly sweaty shirts from the dog's owner around the house before the dog's owner was due to come back, and the dog was not waiting by the door because the smell was still strong in the house, and therefore it didn't think it must be time for the owner to be returning. I mean, it could also be if you feed your dog at exactly the same time, or your cats, then they know it's nearly dinner time because they're beginning to get hungry. If you have a dog, is a dog pleased to see your face when you come home?
Yes. My dog, it really is.
My dog levitates when I return. It is. But it seems that the dogs don't really have a part of the brain that specifically responds to faces.
Wow.
So they did a study in Hungary of domesticated dogs, and they showed them videos of either the back or the front of a human head. And first of all, they preferred dog videos to human videos. And secondly, they didn't seem to care whether it was the back or the front of your head.
Wow.
What part of a human does a dog recognise then? What part of you is it?
Well, actually, I have to say, this is one of the few times where I would dispute something because I swear that my dog can recognise emotion in my face.
But do you think that's actually your face or that dogs can sense feelings more than it's your... They know Sandy's feelings and ups and downs.
It may well be that. I mean, certainly they can read your emotions, I think.
Sometimes you get all three children and the dog all have left the room. He's going off, let's go out. They're all in another room like that together. Have you calmed down? Sorry, everyone, sorry.
Right, cue lighting.
Ooh.
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 Oh. Oh.
What does the spotlight effect feel like?
It points out creeps in our presence.
Wow, that's not nice. What does that feel like?
Well, it seems to be the right answer, because I brought the light.
What does that feel like to...
I love it.
You love it.
It reminds me of being on stage, the only one in the room lit, the only one that can hear...
Go on, Alan.
Dreamland.
Yes, darling, you heard.
Darling.
It's something that maybe you guys are not the right people to do.
A bad focus group. I imagine it's supposed to make you feel a bit uncomfortable and self-conscious.
Spotlight effect is the name that psychologists have given to our tendency to dramatically overestimate how much attention people are paying to us.
I don't think so, Sandy.
In 2000, students were asked to wear a bright yellow Barry Manilow T-shirt to a seminar.
In what year, sorry?
In the year 2000.
OK. And he was, as they said, it's a really cruel experiment.
It is. He was described as a figure of dubious renown. Oh.
That's on his passport.
Among college students.
Oh, is it the...
Yeah. Anyway, afterwards, the wearers of this T-shirt were asked to estimate how many fellow students had noticed that they were wearing this T-shirt, and they overestimated by a factor of two. So it's the spotlight effect. You think that people are looking at you, when in fact they're not really.
Well, maybe it means if you feel vulnerable, you can be seen, you're more vulnerable to a predator. You know, if you're in a herd of antelope or something, you're like, oh, I'm the only one they can see.
Yes.
Because you're wearing a Barry Manilow T-shirt. But of course, the cheetah in the long grass doesn't know anything about Barry Manilow. Just trying to find the slowest, weakest one.
I mean, I'm really trying to make the science that I've got match up with what you just said.
Does the spotlight effect always make us think it's something great? Rather than it's something.
No, it's just
bad.
For example, if you contribute in an argument in a group discussion, people almost always overestimate the extent to which others have noted their contributions. And now I have a horrible sense of foreboding that it's about to be general ignorance. Yes, it is. Ooh. Fingers on buzzers, please. Which composer was completely deaf by the time of their final work?
Beethoven.
Beethoven is the one that we most think. He has always thought to have been deaf at the end of his life. It is popularly believed that he wrote the Ninth and Final Symphony, 1824, and that he couldn't really hear it. Now, we know his hearing did deteriorate, but there is some... I love that there is still research happening, and all these years later, we might decide to change our minds about it. He carried around something called conversation books when his hearing deteriorated, in which his companions could scribble their side of the conversation. He also used them as a sort of diary, writing reminders, shopping lists, like any other human being. And there's a musicologist at the Kent State University in Ohio called Theodore Albrecht, and he has spent decades translating these conversation books into English and found 23 references to Beethoven's hearing in the composer's writing around this time. So, for example, in 1823, Beethoven wrote, "Baths and country air could improve many things. Just do not use mechanical devices, ear trumpets, too early. By abstaining from using them, I have fairly preserved my left ear this way." And that is only a year before the Ninth Symphony. So it's possible that we just were wrong. Not only, according to Professor Albrecht, was Beethoven not completely deaf at the premiere of his Ninth Symphony, he could hear, although increasingly faintly, for at least 2 years afterwards.
I love that we're like, you weren't that good. You were only barely deaf.
You had your left ear, Beethoven. Had your left.
Yeah, that's the most Irish you'll ever be. But I heard he wasn't that deaf, like.
Yeah. Gabriel Fauré, we could have gone for, or Ralph Vaughan Williams. Sadly, deafness caused by the guns of World War I.
Sorry.
I totally fell for it.
You like that?
My dad here.
Beethoven could probably hear the cheers for his final symphony. What did people in the Middle Ages do with their excrement?
Trees of green.
Look for magical stones in it.
Yes. Bezoars.
But then throw it out the window.
No. But there's a picture of someone throwing it out the window.
Well, this is actually an anecdote about King Louis IX of France. And a student poured his pot, as it were, out onto the king. And you would have thought the king would be furious, but the king, in fact, gave him a prebendary, which is a remunerative post in a cathedral, because he was so thrilled to see a young person up early and going about their studies. So you were not supposed to throw your excrement out of the window. Apart from anything else, everybody knew that human waste spread disease. So they did not tip it into the street, they poured it into the nearest river, and the rules were people were responsible for the cleanliness of the streets outside their own houses. In the 1300s, there was one man who was beaten to death for dropping eel skins on the street, and the other people didn't want to have to pay the fine. And larger houses had latrines. And then they had something called a gong farmer, somebody who came and emptied the latrine. There we are, they're taking it off. And towns usually provided public latrines. They were known as places of easement.
Place of easement.
Those two lads.
Yeah.
Like, I'm doing a QI, which is a beloved television show, and I have not even dressed up as well as those two lads going to empty the jacks. Like, yeah. Like that is yeah. bowler hats, waistcoat, whole yeah. shebang. You're probably going to get shit in you. Absolutely.
Gong farmers.
Hats off to the gong farmers.
If you found something in the shit, somebody had dropped coins, whatever, you got to keep it.
Yes, that's lovely. Nice.
I thought you were going to say, like, they did, like, tea readings with poo. Some sort of, like, ooh. Oh.
Yeah. The notion that people emptied their chamber pots out of the window is a load of... Anyway, moving on. At what time of day are you most likely to hear a cock crowing?
Oh. As soon as I bet my eyelashes. How do they know?
They are, people think, famous for crowing at first light of day. Actually, they crow all bloody day, sometimes at night as well. They do often crow at or just before dawn, but basically they then keep going. The interesting thing is that they seem to know it's dawn not because it's light, but because their internal body clock tells them. So they've done tests where they've kept them in sort of dimly lit rooms and they still start crowing at exactly the same time each day. So right. you can rely on them to wake you. It's perfectly fine.
It's one of the few creatures that could swallow its own brain.
What?
What?
Look at the size of its mouth. Its brain has got to get into that tiny head.
Oh, if you fed it,
got it out, it could eat its own brain.
Anyway, they're not crowing because it's light. They're crowing for all sorts of reasons. Right. Warnings, territorial claims, showing dominance, tell other cocks they've just mated. Woo! You know. Their crows are really, really loud. It's an average of 100 decibels if you're standing within a few feet. That's about the same as a chainsaw. Or it could be wow. as much as 143 decibels. So human eardrums rupture at 150 decibels. So why don't cockerels deafen themselves?
Haven't got any ears.
No.
Oh, actually, why would they be bothering telling their mates about the sound?
Why would they bother?
Just Jesse's head is like Sherlock now, but of course.
Yeah, this is shrinking my brain to the point where I could eat it.
They have an inbuilt system to prevent their hearing getting damaged. It is amazing. Half of the bird's eardrum is covered by a bit of soft tissue that Ooh. Dampens the noise. And also, when they tilt their head back to crow, another bit of material covers the ear canal completely and serves as a built-in ear defender.
Oh, so a little bit of minor surgery and they shut up.
Yeah.
Well, the bit nobody talks about is why haven't the hens gone deaf?
Oh, they're all in the corner.
Shut it. Shut it. If you hear a cock crow, it might be morning. Or he might have just got lucky. Let's hear the scores and see if they feel smelly or tasty. In last place, with a sense of shame, frankly, with minus... Wow. Minus 36. Ashley.
No, what happened? I smell a rat. I smell a rat.
With a sense of humour in joint second place with minus 18, it's Roisin and Jessica. And with a sense of purpose with minus 7, it's Alan. So, Roisin, Aisling, Jessica and Alan, and I leave you with this sign-off from Steve Martin about his sense of smell. I cannot smell mothballs because it's so difficult to get their little legs apart. Good night. We'll be right back.